Well, good morning. Hey, I'm glad we get to be together today. My name is Josh. I'm the pastor here at Church on the Drive. If we have not met yet, I'd love to get to meet you after service at some point. You're here on a really great Sunday, whether you're here in the room or you're participating online that way. Hi to you too. Because we are continuing a brand new series that we're calling Love Works. And the reason we're doing that is because there's this long-standing tension all the way from the beginning of Christianity, the very earliest followers of Jesus talked about this, that on the one hand, you want to embrace the love and the grace of God and understand that there's nothing you can do to earn or deserve that love and grace of God. And on the other, there's an expectation that you're going to do something with it, that you are going to live as if God has saved you for a purpose, for a reason, that God has done something for you for a reason, not just for you to sit back and say, happen to me, Jesus, right? That's not what it's all about. So the way they said it and the way we've begun adopting it and thinking about it is this verse that the Apostle Paul wrote a long time ago in a letter to some friends in Galatia, right? He says, the only thing that counts is faith expressing itself through love. Faith expressing itself through love. So our faith should be expressed through the love we show to others and God. You think about the people you love the most in this world. Think about them right there in your brain. You do things to express that love to them, don't you? You do things to express that love all the time. Now, the thing is, when it comes to God, some of us, we express our love a little bit better. When it comes to others and expressing our faith through love, some of us are just a little bit better at things than others. Some of us, we have gifts, we have talents. We're able to talk about our feelings a little bit better. We're able to be more persuasive. We're able to sing a little bit better. And that's how we think we're supposed to express our love to God and to other people. And that's all well and good, but at some point we create these little Christian hierarchies using that. Like, for instance, the pastor has gone and studied these things and talks on stage all the time. They're the person who can lead somebody to faith. I could never do that. They're the one who could do that. That's the ultimate gift. They're the pastor. They got to do the thing. Or maybe you're like me. I look at these people. That little old lady who's been following Jesus for 50 years and has this like 7-hour prayer times in the morning. That lady, she's a great leader in the faith, a great prayer warrior in the faith. But I'm still in my 30s, and I'll never be like that. Or maybe you're a really good singer, and you think you should be up on that stage instead of Sam. Maybe you're a really good singer, at least, you know, in your bathroom when you're alone, and you're like, yeah, I want to sing also, and I need to be up on that stage too. And what we do is we start looking at the gifts and the talents and the abilities that we have, and we compare, whether it's in church or outside of church, right? We are in the comparison business in Western society, right? Especially in America, right? Where the level of the thing that you're good at will determine like how far you go in some places. Like, if you are a really great jurist, and you become this incredible attorney, and then maybe you'll become a judge, and maybe you'll get put on this circuit here, or maybe you'll go over here, and you'll serve over here, and you'll do this, because the assumption is that it's your talent that's going to take you places. Your talent, your level of talent is going to get you into rooms, and so you're always just kind of by nature looking at other people and going, am I better than that person at this thing? And we do that outside of the church and inside the church. It becomes ingrained in us. They come naturally to us in a society like ours where we're always comparing ourselves to other people. But what if I told you that I believe God has something different in mind for us, that when God sent Jesus for us and when Jesus came and showed us what it really looked like to live a God-centered life, that Jesus didn't care what other people thought about his gifts and talents and abilities, and that you don't have to either? And what if I told you that this was an issue, this comparison thing was an issue that people 2,000 years ago, at the very beginning of the whole Christian movement, that they were dealing with this 2,000 years ago, and they figured out how to combat it. Some Christians back then, about 2,000 years ago, were struggling with this in the city of Corinth. Maybe you know a little bit about Corinth, but in case you don't, Corinth was a very rich, profitable town with a lot of upward mobility, a lot of comparison, and a lot of trying to win friends over. We wouldn't know anything about that in America. It seems totally foreign to us, doesn't it? This was a town that had been very important in Greek history. And about the year 146 BC, the Romans sacked it, just totally leveled the place. They had revolted against Rome's rule. And so the local general came in and said, we're going to tear this thing down. We're going to kill off everybody, or we're going to send them off into imprisonment somewhere else in our empire. We're going to do all of that. And there was nothing left. They totally annihilated this town. This is what Rome did when a city or a town or even a village revolted against them. They totally annihilated it. They did everything they could to make sure nobody else inhabited that again. And nobody did inhabit Corinth for about 100 years. And then a guy named Julius Caesar became the emperor of Rome. And Caesar said, well, you know what I'm going to do? I'm going to start a little province, and it's going to be the province of the colony of Corinth in honor of me, Julius Caesar. I'll start it right there at Corinth. 100 years later, nobody who was around back then revolting. It was there, so it's all good. Everybody else has gone off. They don't have any family ties anymore. Also, I have a lot of people in Rome that need to get out of here. This is what Rome would do. They would get some overcrowding happening in Rome and around the city of Rome. A lot of people in this freedmen class, former slaves, or often former soldiers who needed some space of their own. And so one of the ways Rome would reward them is they would send them out to some of these colonies they were starting. And Corinth was one of them. Here's the thing about Corinth. Corinth was strategically positioned on the Greek peninsula, in the most narrow part of the Greek peninsula. And back in those days, boats didn't fare so well when they were sailing around the Greek peninsula. And the thinnest part of this Greek peninsula was actually in the middle of the peninsula. And Corinth was right there in that thinnest part. It's about a 4-mile, 5-mile trek from one side to the other. So what people would do, because they didn't want to sail around the bottom of the Greek peninsula, because people were always having shipwrecks there, people were dying, you were losing a lot of cargo, a lot of money, what they decided to do is they would dock it at Corinth, at Kinkrae, and they would go across to Corinth, or they would dock it at Corinth and go across to Kinkrae, these twin cities. And they built this rock track in between so that you could take all of your cargo off your ship, put it on, and then go across to Kinkrae, or go across to Corinth. And nobody would mess with you. It was this incredible feat in the ancient world. And it made Corinth a very, very rich town. Now, remember all of the people. Remember all the people who were populating this town. Caesar kind of just starts Corinth back up out of nowhere. And he sends people who are hungry. He sends people who want to advance in life, who are seeing for themselves that if they work hard, and if they make the right friends, if they get the right patrons, then they too can be rich, and they too can be somebody of status, because there wasn't this entrenched aristocracy like in all these other big cities like Rome. This was their chance. There was a lot of social and upward mobility. That sounds very familiar to me in 21st century America. And so they did everything they could. They used whatever money they could. They would go highly into debt in order to pay for people to come to their big parties. They were trying to buy their friends. They would come and they would really build up other people so that other person would like them. And then they would kind of stab them in the back a little bit. They would do all the things you think would be terrible. That was the way you advanced in Corinth. And many people from all over the empire realized this was possible in Corinth, that you could climb the social ladder if you went to a place like Corinth. And so they would leave their farms in like Asia and travel to this little town on the Greek peninsula and try to make their fortune there. It's kind of like small town kid from middle of nowhere, Iowa, traveling to New York City, trying to make it. In fact, there's in the ancient world, there's some some writings, and it says, not for everyone is the journey to Corinth. You gotta be tough. Only the tough survive. It was into that context, that this Corinthian church lived. And in a context like that, you're always comparing, you're always looking, you're always examining what other people have going on versus what you have going on and how you can advance, maybe even at their expense. And just like it does in America, the societal culture on the outside of the church made its way into the inside of the church. This is something that happens all the time. I'm not saying everybody's a terrible person. It's just natural for these things to make their way in. We carry our cultural baggage with us everywhere we go, even into church. We just have to recognize it, don't we? We have to see it, recognize it, and understand this lines up with who God is, and this doesn't. So I've got to curb this part that I'm bringing with me to the table. Well, Paul wrote to them to tell them, hey, you need to quit focusing so much on your talents and your abilities. You need to quit focusing so much on what you think you're able to do and what they're able to do. You need to quit focusing on all of that. You need to focus more on God. So what Paul did was he explained to them, hey, every single one of you has gifts that's been given to you by God. Like the Holy Spirit, if God has saved you, then the Holy Spirit has taken up residence within you and has given you special gifts and talents and abilities that you have. And everybody has them, he says. They're not all the same. And everybody has them. And of course, the Corinthians, they're hearing this and they say, yeah, of course. And some people have really good ones and some people don't. Some people are really great. They're great orators. They can get up and they can preach and they can talk about all these amazing mysteries of God. Some other people, they can speak in tongues of other languages somehow, and it's supernatural, and that's really freaky and amazing at the same time. And then there's other people that they know what they're saying, and then there's these other people that can do this. And Paul says, yeah. But they're all just as valuable as the other. And he talks a little bit about a body. He said it's like your body. Like, the eye can't say to another part of the body, I don't want to be an eye anymore. I'm not going to be part of this body if I can't be a hand. That's kind of how churches, church families are supposed to be. That we all come together and we're all part of this body together, and that each one of us is just as valuable as the other, just like our bodies, right? Your ear is just as valuable as your eye, is just as valuable as your fingernails. I don't know if you've ever lost a fingernail. It hurts. It's the worst, and you got to take all these special precautions, and then you don't really realize it. Like, you can't do some things with that hand for a little bit because there's not a fingernail there to kind of provide a little bit of structure. It hurts even more. No, it's all important, and it was all important in the Corinthian church. They just didn't recognize it because they were so used to comparing themselves to others. And they were saying, well, Paul, you don't get it. You don't get it. Like, this person has a lot of money, and this person is a great speaker, and this person is really good at talking to other people. And Paul says, yeah. Everybody brings something to the table. Can I say that to you really quickly? Can you just remember that? If you remember nothing else today, can you remember that? That each person in this room, each person watching online, you bring something of value to the table in the kingdom of God. And God has rendered that so. Not me, not you. God has made sure that you have something of value to add to the kingdom of God. Never look down on yourself or anybody else. Well, Paul writes this to them and he says, look, we all have these gifts. We all have these gifts, and I know you're comparing them all, but let me talk about it in this way. He brings it home, and he says this. He says, if I speak in the tongues of men or of angels, but do not have love, I am only a resounding gong or a clanging cymbal. A resounding gong or a clanging cymbal. You may not know this about me. I went to a smaller Christian college. And while I was there, it was kind of in vogue for some people to have a life verse. It was like, this is the verse that, like, I want on my tombstone or whatever. This is the verse that kind of defines my life. And I've never really bought into that, but then I came across these next three verses, and they meant so much to me. They meant so much to me because of what we're about to talk about. When he's saying, if I speak in the tongues of men or of angels, he's saying, if I'm the most eloquent speaker you ever heard of, if I can say things that are so amazing to you that it just blows you away, if I can convince anybody of anything, if it's miraculous, the stuff that I'm saying, but I don't have love, then I'm just like a banging gong or a cymbal or something like that. Hard to understand somebody like that, isn't it? It's hard to understand somebody who doesn't have love. They're trying to convince you of something, but they don't have love while they do it. And this is why we don't want to spend too much time talking about them, but we've heard of these different groups who go and they boycott funerals or they stand on the sidewalks and they have hateful messages on there and they invoke God's name somehow. And they wonder why nobody believes them. They wonder why they're not winning over any converts. Because your motives may be pure, but you don't have love. And the same is true for people like me. It's the same for people like you. Maybe you are an incredible, eloquent speaker, and you could win people to faith. But if you don't have love, it's all going to get lost in the noise. He goes on. He says, look, if I have the gift of prophecy, which is pretty cool. Like, if I have the gift of prophecy and I can walk up and tell you everything that's going wrong and how you need to fix it, or I can tell you what's coming, that's a pretty big gift. And I can fathom all mysteries and all knowledge. This is like the smartest person ever. If I have that, and if I have a faith that can move mountains, if I have a faith that can move a mountain, like I can literally say to that mountain to go over there, if I have... This is pretty impressive. If you knew this person in church and you were talking to them, you'd be impressed by this person. You think this was the greatest person ever. We got to listen to this person. This person should be our pastor. This person is it. But if they don't have love, I am nothing. I am nothing. You may think I'm the most impressive person. You may think I've got it all together. But if I don't have love, I got nothing. I've got nothing. Paul's being emphatic here. And I want you to understand what he's saying. That none of that other stuff that's so impressive matters if you don't have love. Then he says this in verse 3. If I give all I possess to the poor and give over my body to hardship that I may boast, but do not have love, I gain nothing. What do you mean? Even if I don't. If I serve others, if I'm at the soup kitchen every day, if I sell my house and give all the proceeds to the Christian Service Center or to Second Harvest Food Bank, if I sell my house and I use the money to move to Asia and I'm there and I'm trying to serve the poor and I'm building an orphanage and I've got all these kids coming in, you're telling me that if I do that, I can still gain nothing? And Paul says, uh-huh, yeah. If you don't have love, you gain nothing. If you're doing all of that just so you feel better, if you're doing all that so people will look at you and think you're somebody, and you don't actually have love for the poor that you're serving, you gain nothing. And that's true. That's true. It's all for naught if you don't really love those people. But then Paul takes it a step further, and he says this. Love never fails. Love never fails. You got all that stuff, all these gifts and all these talents and all of these abilities. You can serve with the best of them. You can preach with the best of them. You can sing with the best of them. You can administrate with the best of them. You can have the greatest gift of hospitality ever. You've got all of those things going for you. But if you don't have love, it doesn't matter. Why? Because love never fails. That's the thing that never fails. That's the thing that never goes wrong. If you can love, that's the thing. He goes on, he says, but where there are prophecies, they will cease. Remember, that's the cool gift. That's the one everybody in Corinth was really wanting. Those will cease. Where there are tongues, They will be stilled. Where there is knowledge, it will pass away. All of that other stuff is going away. None of that stuff lasts forever, Paul says. What will last is love. And it's true when you think about that. I think all of us can remember somebody in our life who made us feel loved, like really, really loved, or made us feel a severe lack of love at some point, right? I think we can all think about that. We'll forget everything that they were good at, but we won't forget how they made us feel. It's like that old Maya Angelou quote. You've heard this before. I've learned that people will forget what you said, people will forget what you did, but people will never forget how you made them feel. I was talking yesterday with Camille. We were at the beach, and we were walking, and we were talking about teachers that we had, and I was thinking back to some of my teachers that I had, some of the best teachers I had. There's some of them who were just funny, you know, just funny. And we were talking about how teachers are people too, so we got to give them breaks, and we got to have a little grace for them. But when I think back on the teachers that I had in my life, there were the ones who didn't understand me very well. I was a wild kid, believe it or not. I was a little bit wild, and I was definitely the class clown. I mean, period. I was that guy. And some teachers took that in stride. Some teachers did not like that at all. Some teachers celebrated who I was, and they used that as leverage to help me become who they knew I could be. I don't remember which one of my teachers was the best like at scaffolding things. I don't remember which one of my teachers was the best at teaching me concepts. I remember the teachers. I remember how they made me feel. I remember if they believed in me. I remember if they made me feel loved. I remember if I felt safe around them. I remember people like Miss Bailey, who when I was accused of something, believed me instantly and fought for me. I still remember, I mean, that was like, I don't know, 25 years ago. I still remember that. I still remember the feeling, the pride I felt because she believed me. That adult had my back. And then she went into the principal's office and advocated for me. She showed her love. It went into action. She didn't just say, yeah, I believe you. I'm going to stay here. Like, she went and she fought for me. But then I had teachers who tried to tear me down, to make me fall in line. And those weren't great experiences. Y'all, what I want you to do is I want you to take your gifts, your talents, your abilities that God put inside of each and every one of you. And I want you to use those gifts to share love with the world. I want you to do that. See, whether we're talking about spiritual gifts or natural abilities, and a lot of times there's a overlap there and an interplay, an exchange there. Whether they're natural or just God gave them to you when you got saved or something, I want you to use those gifts and talents and abilities for God's kingdom. Because what you're doing when you're expanding God's kingdom is you're expanding God's reach of love in the world. When Jesus came, Jesus inaugurated a new way of life, a new world entirely. And so wherever we go, what we're doing is we're setting up these little outposts of the kingdom of God that Jesus inaugurated. And in those little outposts, we're supposed to live like Jesus taught us to live. We're supposed to live in the way Jesus modeled for us to live. It's not just in church, but it's also in your home. It's also in the workplace. It's also out at the ball field. It's also out at the gas station, wherever you go. It's where you find yourself. The way of the kingdom should be present with you everywhere you go. And the way of the kingdom is love. Paul said, these three things remain: faith, hope, and love. And the greatest of these is love. So what I want you to do, maybe we can just remember this succinct way. Your abilities are the feet your love has for walking. The things you're good at, the things you're able to do are the feet that your love has for walking. Maybe you're never gonna be a singer up on a stage in church. Maybe you are an incredible financial analyst. Use that to show love. You might say, well, how do I do that? I don't know, I'm not a financial analyst. But you are. You are. And that's what we mean when we say, work out your faith with fear and trembling every day. You're figuring this out. You're trying to grow closer to God wherever you find yourself, and you're trying to love others well wherever you find yourself and whoever you find yourself around. Now, if I were you, and I was sitting where you're sitting right now, what I'd be asking myself is this: but how do I love? How? Some people are awful. And I just don't always like people. Maybe you're like that. You're like, man, I don't find it easy to love others. I don't find it easy to spend time with them either. And I don't even know what it means to love them well. I'm pretty new to this thing. Well, I'll give you three pieces of advice. The first is pray about it. When you pray about these things, I mean really earnestly pray. Not like give a lot of effort and like straining into it. I'm saying really pray about it. Really be thoughtful in your prayer. Especially if you're praying for that person that's hard to love, pray for them. Pray for them. You'll be amazed what happens as you pray for them. Like something changes in our heart. We start seeing them a little bit differently. And as you do that, I want you to try to see the innocence in others. That's my second piece of advice. Try to see the innocence in others. You ever think about that? There's some people that we would say, no, they're too far gone. They're so far gone. But I want you, if there's ever somebody in your life like that, I want you to try to imagine them as like a three-year-old child. Just think about them as like a two- or three-year-old child. And that innocence they have to them, that loving spirit that they have to them at that age. Because something happened in between that time and the time that you began to know them and they were just grating all over your nerves or doing terrible things. Something happened, and it probably wasn't their fault. What if you could see the innocence that still exists in them that was there when they were 3 years old? What if you could try to view them that way? I think you might be able to love them a little bit easier. It won't be perfect, but I think you have a better shot at loving them. Here's the last thing. Live like it's real. Maybe you can say fake it till you make it. Live like it's real. Like live as if it's true that you love that person. That you're not going to talk bad about them. You're not going to talk poorly about them. You're going to live as if it's true that you are good at loving others. You're going to live as if it's true that you are good at loving others, that you are good at taking care of other people, that you don't talk poorly. You never diminish another person in your life. If you can't say anything nice, you don't say anything at all. You live like it's true. You'll be amazed, I think, at how this starts happening for real in your life. Friends, Jesus said this: no greater love has anyone than this, than to lay down their life for their friends. And then the Apostle Paul comes along behind him and he says, this is how we know what love is. While we were sinners, Christ Jesus died for us. While we were enemies of God, Jesus died for us. That's what love is. It's put into action. It's never just there. It's never just words. It's never just something somebody says. It's put into action. There are works behind it. Your abilities are the feet your love has for walking. Would you let me pray for you for a moment? If you would, just bow your head and close your eyes. I just want to give you a moment to reflect. I'm not going to ask you to walk forward or to raise your hand or anything like that. I just want to give you a moment to reflect quietly in this room together. Maybe I'm talking about you. Maybe you struggle with love. Maybe that's been a little bit of a struggle for you. Or maybe you've noticed that you have a lot of talk being talked, but not a lot of walk being walked. If that's you, I want to invite you to make a commitment today, just inwardly, and then maybe talk to somebody about it in a little while. Make a commitment today that those people you struggle to love, you're going to pray for them. You're going to try to find the innocence in them. That in the course of your daily life, you're going to look for ways that you can serve others because of the love that's been lavished upon you. I want you to think about this as you go through your daily life. I want you to think about the love that's been lavished upon you by the God of the universe who doesn't need you, but wants every part of you, no matter who you are, where you've been, or who you've been with. That as a response, that this incredible love of God that's been lavished upon you by the God of the universe, that you could only help but send it back out into the world. Lord, I pray for my brothers and my sisters that are hearing me. I pray that you would help them to feel your love so strongly on their life and in their heart that they couldn't help but share it with others, that they couldn't help but want to make life better for the people around them, that they couldn't help but try to make this world a little bit more like the kingdom of God that you have envisioned. Lord, help us in everything we do to love others the way you loved us. Amen. Would you stand with us and let's sing again?
What a beautiful song. Great job, guys. Today, if you're ready to take your next steps with us, we invite you to do that. You can text the word next to 407-753-9656, and someone from our leadership team will reach out to you, and we'd definitely love for you to do that and to hear from you. This week, we have a challenge. You only have 1 week. Josh made it very clear to me that's 1 week. It will not be extended, but go home, go through your closet. Any old shoes or shoes you don't wear anymore, they're lightly used. If the tongues are flapping on them, those aren't the ones that we need. But bring them next Sunday because we're going to be sending them to Guatemala. My initial thought was that's a great time for you to get rid of some of those heels, but I don't think that's what we're looking for. So please do that. Bring them with you next week. Also, this Saturday, we're having a church game night, both for kids and adults. Child care is going to be provided, so there's a little extra incentive to come out and play some games with your church family. But we're really excited for that to happen. And just know, as you walk out these doors and into that world, that this church loves you, and so does the God of the universe. Have a great week.